Excited to start this. Hey guys, I'm Hardy Fowler. I've got some of my awesome Academy students with me today, so thanks for showing up. But for those of you I haven't worked with before, my name is Hardy Fowler. I'm a professional concept artist and illustrator with over a decade of experience in the industry. And I started a digital painting studio to be a resource for artists trying to launch a career, trying to break in and build the skills that you need to compete in today's market. It's kind of what I'm all about. I've sort of transitioned to that full-time in the past year, and it's what I'm passionate about. So if this is our first time chatting together, I hope you'll all consider me a resource and definitely check out Digital Painting Studio for all kinds of ways that we can help artists achieve their goals. But today is going to be cool. I have this incredibly efficient technique that I want to share that just does this magic trick of making really professional results freakishly fast. So I know we really overpromised with our event title here, but it's pretty legit. This is very cool. So we'll just jump right into it. And anyone in the Zoom is welcome to chime in. If you have a question, you can put it in the chat. Feel free to interrupt and ask something if you would like to. But basically, what we're going to do today is use the symmetry tool in Photoshop to very quickly come up with a bunch of designs. And we're going to sort of develop one of them. Working professionally as a concept artist, as in many fields, time is money. The amount of work that you can crank out in one day is how you become profitable. So efficiency becomes a really big priority. And this tool really made that just step up a huge notch. So I want to make sure everybody who wants to be admitted is here before I start. Looks like we're good. So if you have never used it before, the symmetry tool in Photoshop is this little butterfly icon. And there are all kinds of crazy setups. In its simplest form, it's just this mirror reflection. And think of this as like an ink blot test. It simply reflects exactly what you do on one side over to the other. And at first, I didn't see a huge use for that as a digital painter. It seems like a fun, like arts and crafts type thing, but I didn't immediately grasp the power of this as a design tool until later. There are some really cool other options too, if you just want to play around with this. This one is fun too, the spiral. It can let you just do these really quick spirograph-like patterns. Weirdly, when I'm designing, been working on a sci-fi video game project, and I've been designing all these really cool like aperture-style doors with this, and it just becomes insanely quick and easy to make something that looks really complex and ornate with just a handful of lines. So anyway, there are all kinds of kind of higher iterations, more complex uses of this tool. But for today, let's just go with good old vertical symmetry. And I'm just going to start blocking in some shapes to make kind of a cool ship design, sort of like the one in the thumbnail. But I might do a few just to show how easy this is to create some very quick thumbnails and just explore. My Academy students will definitely know a few very important shape design fundamentals that I'm going to be leaning on really heavily here. And that combined with this tool is practically all you need to find things that just work and feel cool. So to start with, just thinking of little like insectoid type shapes. I'm going to be sort of transforming and editing these on the fly, but we're evoking some cool, like, yeah, it sort of looks like a crab or some hostile sea creature. And I like how I can sort of jump to the left and right side of the canvas just to, I don't know, if a mark feels more comfortable diagonaling in this way, then I'll just do it on that side. But if I want to diagonal on this way, I can do it on that side. So you have a lot of freedom. You can kind of do what works best for your own hand. And this tool just makes that easy. Symmetry is this really powerful artistic concept. It's something that we are kind of hardwired to recognize, and it just makes something, especially a mechanical object, feel more authentic and machine. If we just make a mark on one side of a canvas, you know, these shapes that I'm making could kind of be anything, but if we reflect that and make a perfect copy of it on the other side, suddenly our brain kind of recognizes this as like something. It's something that's just really hardwired into our brains. And that's what this tool does for you. It makes just about anything you do on one side, it could kind of just look like a blob of paint, kind of turns it into a thing, which is really cool. So just to kind of iterate a little bit and see if we can try something else, I'm going to do another one. Thumbnailing in just initial exploration is a big part of the job of being a concept artist. So having this really nice, efficient way to get a lot of different looks in front of a client is really valuable. And it's one of those nice kind of hacks that can make it seem like you've done a lot of really kind of laborious work, but you haven't. You're doing these things pretty quickly and efficiently, and that's always a good thing. This would be a really fun thing to do monsters too. It works particularly well with this hard surface stuff. Robots, spaceships, things like that. But there are all kinds of other applications for this. Trying to make these shapes kind of have that harmonious relationship that we're always searching for, and that these really powerful core design principles that we discuss in the Academy, it makes this really formulaic and really accessible too. You can just sit down with some shapes and arrive at a cool result. It's kind of a really refreshing way that you can take something as subjective as just what looks cool artistically and make it into something that's a formula that you can rely on, so that the magic is there when you reach for it. I kind of like this one, but just for the sake of really exploring, let's try one more. I think we're only 10 minutes in, and I've got two thumbnails that I quite like, and I really just feel incredibly loose and free doing this. There's just not a lot of real heavy lifting going on here, which is kind of refreshing. Design is taxing on your brain. You are really engaged and firing on all cylinders when you're applying your design brain to a project. So anything that can make that process just instantly way easier is gold and is a really handy tool. sticking with the kind of like insectoid vibe for these, I think that works really well with the kind of ship that I have in mind. Always thinking of like really great examples from games or movies that inspired me. And I always really loved the Superman movie, Man of Steel, the kind of newish one when Zack Snyder first rebooted it. The Krypton ship was really Beetle-like. Always loved that one. And I think that is kind of subconsciously informing this one too. But insectoid ships just always work well. Mind you, that Galaga game too. Pew, pew, pew. Cool. This is a little tough. I kind of like all of these. Probably that one. Let's call this one the winner, unless I start seeing a bunch of faces like hugely objecting. We'll go ahead with this. So I'm going to iterate. I'm going to make this bigger and let's start refining this guy. And I've still got the symmetry tool active. You can kind of switch it on and off here, and you can do last use symmetry. If you turn it off, it kind of brings back the exact same one that you had so that you don't lose it. Pretty handy. So now that I know I like my main shapes, we've got all these core design principles working pretty well. Now I'm kind of zooming in to start some sort of second level details. And it is so organic and alien now, I am actually going to pivot just a little bit with the design language. I'm going to start adding some little elements that make it seem more man-made, so that we can kind of bring this back to like a human piece of technology that might just be really futuristic. And I think that would be super cool. So what I mean by that is like more square edges, little aerodynamic fins, little things that make it seem engineered, like it was actually made in a factory somewhere and not like it's some big alien bug thing. So I'm trying to work in a few more straight lines, but I still like keeping this overall curviness of the forms, kind of the main large forms. Cool. What else? Things like hoses, little lines bringing fuel or coolant or something from one part of the ship to another, or little areas of kind of busier mechanical bits that make this seem like a machine. And still with the symmetry tool active, it's doing twice the work with, you know, the same amount of effort, which is awesome. And it's still doing that magic thing of, because it's a perfect reflection, because we're seeing that mirrored symmetrical side, it makes it just more real. It kind of instantly registers with your viewer as something that is real, is believable, is like mechanically plausible. And that's what we're trying to do. Sweet. Don't love this. Might just fill this in and apply some more active stuff, but I think that works quite well. I think I'm going to call that just about a finished silhouette. A few last minute little details. And if you try this yourself, I hope you are attempting this or will attempt this after the stream, but spend as much time as you need. I know I'm kind of demonstrating this as like this big speed efficiency thing, but take some time, like really make friends with this tool and enjoy all the cool stuff that's possible with it. don't feel the need to like fly through this like I am. But cool, let's call that a finished silhouette. And I'm going to save this as demo. All right, so next, let's add a little bit of highlight. Let's start defining the interior shapes of this form. And my Academy students will know this technique as the carve out method. I love this, and it works insanely well with the symmetry tool. So we're basically doing the same process, but instead of making a silhouette, I'm going to come up with some highlight shapes. This is really cool. We're still doing a lot of that shape design stuff that we did to invent our silhouette, but now we are also defining value a little bit. We're kind of shining a light on this form and describing it as a three-dimensional object, something that has light and dark on it, something that has form. I'm kind of trying to make this cockpit sort of coming out towards us a little bit. And I'm also trying to still do those same shape design principles, trying to have all these things balanced and harmonious. It's sort of this part in the process where you're making decisions about what is closer to you and what is farther back. So let me kind of see if I want these little thrusters to be in front or way back. Oh, another kind of just quick Photoshop hack that I want to point out is the smoothing function with the brush tool. That is just one of the biggest upgrades that Photoshop has done in like the last decade. It just instantly makes your lines seem way more confident, and it makes designs like this so much easier than they otherwise would be. So if you aren't familiar, smoothing kind of makes your lines smoother, obviously, but it takes all the wobble out. If your hand is lacking confidence with line art or paintings like this, this is a game changer. So just wanted to point out that I was definitely making some good use of the smoothing function as well. Cool. I always love the cockpit part of a ship. You get to kind of lean back on that insectoid reference. It makes it seem like a face. And I always like a ship that has these kind of hooded parts behind the neck. It seems like a lot of bugs have that, and it just always seems to work well. So finding little places to add and subtract detail and just make this come to life. And also keeping the design language in mind, kind of floating between the really organic, buggy look and bringing it back to this very man-made, mechanical type of thing. Always kind of fading back and forth, bouncing around.
Hey, Hardy.
Yes.
We've got a question from YouTube. Someone's asking where you get this brush from.
I'm happy to share it. This is actually, there's really nothing special about this one. It's just this diamond shape. I've got the spacing set really low. It's at 1% so that it's very solid. But all it's really doing is making this shape when I press down. And that's kind of all there is to it. But I will definitely make the brush available. I'm not sure if I can share the file by Zoom, but if we could, I guess, grab contact information from whoever asked, I'm happy to just send an AVR file. But yeah, this is a pretty simple one.
Hey, Hardy.
Yes.
Matt Taylor here. Thank you for doing this, by the way. Just sure. A quick question. When you're picking your brushes, like using the diamond shaped one, do you make a determination, say if you're doing an organic form or a human or monster, whatever, are you more likely to use a round brush? Did you consciously pick the diamond because even subtly it might have more angular features to it, or how did that come about?
Great question. And yes, those kinds of considerations are definitely part of it. Weirdly though, whenever I try to like apply logic to it, like what you just described, it seems to always end up working in some different way that I didn't expect. So for example, I use this brush to paint clouds lately, which I never would have suspected that this, I mean, it's the least organic looking shape you can imagine. So yeah, totally. But it rarely works out in the tidy way that I thought it would make sense. But that's a great point. I've been using this brush just for a lot of things lately, just because I like it. I kind of just like the way when you are making a line one way, it's a certain thickness, but then if you turn a corner, it becomes thicker. It ends up kind of describing forms a little bit differently. As another example, and just to jump brushes really quickly, I've been using brushes like this for landscapes a lot lately, totally off topic. But I do this because you can make like a cliff edge and then a mountain and then another cliff edge and then a mountain. You can kind of define terrain really easily. So brush tip shape can really help you in that way. But at the same time, I have yet to crack the code on like why something works sometimes. It's just one of those things that you sort of figure out what works best for you along the way. And as one kind of overarching truism about brushes is the best brushes you have are always the ones that you made for yourself and kind of customized and made it work for you. So whenever you download a brush pack or buy a brush pack somewhere, it rarely seems to do exactly what you thought it would do or what was advertised. So kind of the pros and also a word of caution about brushes, but that's a great question. I could talk about brush philosophy all day. And please chime in if you have any other questions. I'm definitely happy to paint and chat, but I have switched to my eraser tool, which kind of also arbitrarily is just a square. Also have smoothing set pretty high because now I am subtracting away some lines to give a little more interest to these interior forms. And once again, the symmetry tool makes this just magic. I mean, this looks like this super realistic bit of mechanical paneling now, just because we've carved some seams into this, which is awesome. I think I'm doing a few too many though. Always need to find that right balance. Design balance is one of our most important core design fundamentals. And it's basically balancing out areas of high visual activity, really like the busy areas, with other spots that are not so visually active. So that's something that Academy students have gotten really awesome at over the design module, and just one of those really nice kind of formulaic tools that can give you nice results pretty much every time you reach for it. But these little lines and seams, and as you can see, I'm kind of putting in little vent holes, little dots here, just for those design considerations. One of my favorite things about making ships is that you are kind of free to do whatever you need to in terms of visual design to make it work. If you need an extra fin because it would look cooler for your design, you're pretty much free to do that, especially if it is a spaceship, if it's not at all constrained by like aerodynamics, then you are really free, which is awesome. Same thing with robots, or to another degree, creatures that don't exist. If you just need to make up a dragon and it would look cool if it had horns on the back of its head, add some horns. You're kind of totally free to do that. Okay, coming along here, I think I'm getting pretty detailed with a lot of these shapes. Oh, I have an idea. I'm going to divide this space into two like air intakes. Oh, I love it.
Hey, Hardy, we've got another question from YouTube.
Awesome. Fire away.
Someone says, designing thumbnails, should you consciously apply the design principles, or is it better to edit and revise afterwards so as not to make the design too formulaic?
That is a great question. I guess my answer would be whichever way is feeling like it works best for you. No, totally. You don't want it to seem like robotic and like something you've just, you know, used an algorithm to create or something. But at the same time, I think you do need to be somewhat conscious of this stuff, even at the thumbnail phase. I think that's what makes a design seem very, you know, like a professional designer had their hands on it, is applying these principles. So even at the thumbnail phase, I would. But in the very beginning, I think just total freedom, just slapping shapes out there, trying to find that magic happy accident. There's definitely value to that. So I think it's great to kind of start loose and tighten up as you go. I think that certainly is valid as well. But fundamentals should really be guiding those decisions, even at a pretty early phase. But great question. And this is getting pretty far along. In fact, for a carve-out design, I don't really think we would need to take it too much farther than this. In fact, I think we can spend our remaining time, just so that I don't go too far along, with some rendering. But before I finish there, contrast, another one of those incredibly important fundamental things that we need to do. So weirdly, we can even use contrast with symmetry. So what I mean by that is everything in this image is symmetrical. So let's have something somewhere that is not symmetrical. So maybe off to one side of the cockpit, there's like a little smaller room where, you know, like a guy controls the guns sits or something. So just some tiny little expression of asymmetry, and it really improves things. It's something we talk about a lot in character design too. If we have a character who is mostly, you know, recognizably the same on both sides of their midline, but they have one big piece of armor on one shoulder, like the shield side, little things like that just seem to always look cool. All right, I think this is working well. I'm going to kind of, just for presentation, start making this into something kind of moody, just with some gradients. This won't take long at all, but this is a really cool thing we can do. Once we have captured this, oh wait, do we have people waiting? Shoot. Sorry, I didn't see you guys waiting in there, but we will post this on YouTube later, and welcome. Once we have this highlight shape really on its own layer, and I've just made a copy of it, we can totally control this. So I'm going to darken this to make it very dark. And now is where we can lock the transparency on this layer and paint within it. And this is probably overkill in a pro project. I don't know if I would really need to do this necessarily, but this just looks really cool. So I've got the transparency locked, and with a soft airbrush, I'm just going to selectively highlight this just a bit. Just like there is a spotlight somewhere above this. Maybe it's like a city patrol craft or something, kind of like the helicopter of the horrifying dystopian future that we are designing here. So just by adding a few little areas of highlight and trying to stick to the form a little bit, like this boxy shape below would be facing up towards the light source. Same thing here. Maybe I can cast a few shadows between these like overlapping hood parts. And it just instantly adds a lot of polish and interest. And this is one of those great things where we're getting all of this practically for free. Once the shapes are there, it just works for you pretty much magically. There's not a lot of extra work here. It's just doing a bit of airbrushing. I'm going to make a few of these shapes really fade away to help sell that effect. But that's the main idea. I think that's pretty cool. To take that one step farther, I've created a new layer. And since we have all of these nice lines carved through this, if I command click on the highlight shape layer, see how it makes a selection of the shape? Well, now I'm going to stroke that selection and it will make an outline. Let's try 4 pixels, too big. Nice. So now it's like in Tron suddenly. But what we can do is tone that way down. Excuse me. Okay. If I mask the entire layer out by adding a layer mask, that lets me selectively reveal. And it just makes every little line that we carved into the ship have this little edge to it. It helps us just here and there kind of add a little bit of extra punch to those lines, and it makes it look cool. It just helps to define it. I love that trick. And these are all just ways of getting extra effects for free, which is just always awesome. With all these nice like shadow areas, we're sort of setting ourselves up for some nice opportunities to put some little, you know, twinkly, blinky lights in the shadows. And you know what I should do is turn symmetry back on so that I can just do this once and it will show up on both sides. Sticking to our asymmetry, we can add a little something different on one side. And guys, I think that is a pretty finished concept that took us a little over half an hour. I think that's definitely something that can help a concept artists have a lot of efficiency and get a lot of work done in a single workday. Just adding a spotlight just to add some extra coolness here. But that's basically the demo. I hope you guys find that really useful. It's basically just using the Photoshop tool and applying some design principles and a few little extra tricks to make it look a little more polished. But I get a lot of use out of this professionally, and I hope it works for you too. But yeah, definitely wanted to open up the floor for some questions. But before we jump into that, I just wanted to make everyone aware of a special that we are running for the next couple of weeks. The next session of Concept Art Academy enrollment is open for that. The next session will start on January 4th. And my current session has been fantastic. A lot of these talented artists are here today, and they've been amazing. I hope they feel the same way. It's been a really great experience with a lot of talents and a lot of really huge steps forward. So I just wanted everyone to be aware that the next session has enrollment open. We are also starting a special for today, where if you enroll, I think before December 17th, you will be enrolled in the winter session at a discount, and you will have access to the other bundles on Digital Painting Studio, which is Digital Painting Core and Digital Painting Pro. So it's basically designed to be this entire year of a concept artist's journey. You can start building core painting skills like painting people and drawing with digital painting apps. Then you would move into Concept Art Academy, which is where we gain these pro level skills, how to design and how to paint in a professional level and how to build a portfolio. And finally, Digital Painting Studio Pro, I kind of think of it as like graduate school. If you want to do a really deep dive into an individual topic like painting machines or creatures or characters, any of those disciplines that a concept artist needs to be good at to compete, there is an individual course for each one of those. So you can really make that portfolio as complete and as competitive as possible. So we will definitely put a link in the chat. And when I post this later, it will be in the YouTube description as well. But really, I would definitely recommend taking advantage of that offer, because it's a ton of value packed into one package and some really transformative results that we're seeing in the current session. So hope to see a lot of you guys in there. But that being said, that's my speech. That's the demo. If there are any questions, feel free to chime in if you're in Zoom, or Celine, if you see any more in the YouTube chat, I'm happy to field those as well. But yeah, fire away if you have any questions.
Yeah, Hardy?
Yes.
Yes, I'm Adam, I'm from Argentina.
And hey.
Just, I wanna thank you for all, because I buy your courses many long time ago. And sorry, I'm not an English speaker, but I will try my best. And thanks to you, I picked my first job. And today, actually, I'm an art director for a small company in a video game studio. So I wanna thank you. I wanna say thank you for teaching me all your secrets, all your tricks. And it's been a hard work for me, but it's a pleasure to me to be here. It's all. That's it.
Wow! Thank you so much for saying that, and huge congratulations. That's such an awesome milestone, and that's all you, man. I'm glad I could help, but you did the work, and that is fantastic. I'm so glad that you are working professionally. That's always such a huge milestone. And that's like my favorite thing to find out when a student crosses into the professional realm. So I wish you the best, and I hope you'll stay in touch and kind of share what you're working on as you can. But thank you so much for saying so. And it's absolutely my pleasure.
Thanks, Hardy.
We've got a question from YouTube, Hardy.
Okay, cool. I hope it's exactly like Alan's.
It's someone's asking, would you be able to do this with a monster design?
Yes. Kind of. I think to get started, the weird thing about monsters is that pose and, you know, energy, is it hunched over? Is it walking or running? That ends up playing a bigger role. And these end up being very static, you know, perfect symmetry. You end up with that mannequin type pose. So you definitely could, to kind of define shapes and forms and things like that. I can't think of a time when I have personally used this for a monster design. I think you could, though. That definitely might be another video I try to post. I've been wanting to try like a creature face doing this, kind of symmetry reflection, just to see what kind of different renderings you could do based on that midline. So I'll bet you could. I haven't tried it yet, but now I want to. Great question. I think I'm just really starting to scratch the surface of what this can do. It's one of those nice tools where you want to work within what the tool can do, but you always want to be conscious that it could be tying you down a little bit. So you never want these things to limit you or, you know, make you feel like you're stuck in a process. But I would definitely like to try that with creatures, but I haven't yet. Good question.
Looks like we've got a question in the chat from Amelia. She's saying she's doing 5 portraits a week, and she's wondering if it's okay to use references for that.
Absolutely. Results are all that matters, I think, is that's sort of the rule I live by. So definitely. That's more of like a rendering challenge, just kind of helping us all take our technique to the next level. Photos are totally cool for that. The only word of caution I would use is that if you're working professionally, if it's an image that you are selling, you always want to make sure that you are miles away from any reference material that you use, just because copyright concerns start getting kind of tricky if you use a reference too heavily. But for this challenge, absolutely, go nuts. Cool. Yeah, any more questions? I think we can probably go ahead and start wrapping it up if there aren't any other questions. But
Artie, I got a quick question.
Yeah, sure, Matt. Fire away.
For all those courses you mentioned and stuff, they're yes. all going to be Photoshop-centric for the most part, but broadly applicable to like Procreate for very specific, may or may not be using that instance.
Totally. All the courses are taught using Photoshop. That's my weapon of choice, but I very deliberately make them all pretty software independent. It's mostly about techniques and concepts. Of course, after I've just demonstrated this very specific Photoshop tool, but a lot of my students use Procreate. And with very few exceptions, there's really nothing that Photoshop will do that Procreate can't. So if that's the one you're comfortable with, you'll do beautifully in all of our courses. And if as a Procreate user, I'm curious, do you know if Procreate has a mirroring symmetry type function like Photoshop?
Yes, sir, it does. It took me a minute to find it, but it's... under the canvas information for anyone using it, there's where the perspective tool is. You can also set it to symmetry. You can set that to be horizontal, vertical, or diagonal, just kind of how you did. I don't think it has that spiral thing you used as an example though, but you could probably meet that somehow.
Thank you. That's awesome to know. that's the way it tends to be with most of these functions. There's some kind of analogous function across the apps. And even if you go into like Affinity or Clip Studio Paint, there's usually some way to make just about all of this stuff work. But I think it's much more about technique, mindset, and just the concepts involved that really lead to improvement in work. So any app that you're comfortable with will probably work.
We've got a couple more questions, Hardy. Awesome. You've got more time. So someone says that they do mostly environment design, and they're wondering if they should master both 2D and 3D design.
Very good question. So personally, I don't use 3D at all, but that doesn't mean that you shouldn't. I think the more tools you have in your kit, the more competitive you will be as a professional, especially if you're kind of in that just entering the job market phase in your career. I think having 3D skills definitely gives you an advantage, especially with environment stuff. It's so nice to be able to not really worry about perspective and defining those large spaces just by blocking in your main elements in a 3D program. There's definitely some value to that. I personally have found the digital painting, just the sketchy ways to start a landscape, faster and easier than my attempts into 3D in the past. That might just have been, you know, the fact that I prefer 2D, and, you know, it's hard for me to stretch out of my comfort zone. So that's kind of my personal take on it. But if you like 3D and if you have some experience with it, I would definitely keep developing that and keep it as part of your workflow, because the more tools you have in your kit, the more competitive you are. That's a great question. Kind of this ongoing concept artist debate is, how much 3D do I need to have involved in my process? I think you can get by just fine without any, but everything that you can add to your toolkit helps.
Nice. Okay, we've got a couple in the Zoom chat as well. Do you think digital art will find its way to a more commercial application, example, for visualizing corporate visions to make it their strategy and vision fast visible for all employees?
Totally. And actually, just already, I think there are so many crazy uses for digital painting, and just, you know, any way that art has been used historically, this is kind of basically the standard for how commercial art is made now. So, wow, I mean, lots of stuff. I have personally worked as a medical illustrator, making anatomical diagrams. So that was kind of what I went to school to study, and taught myself digital painting through online learning and just relentless trial and error. So there are so many different applications for this, but yeah, a corporate thing, any kind of visualization. I think architectural pre-viz is something that I've seen a good bit of. But yeah, tons of applications. I'm not sure if I'm addressing the one you mentioned specifically, but I think basically if you can imagine it, and if there's art involved in it, then digital painting can be involved somehow. So I think the future is incredibly bright for commercial artists. Just the amount of media and visual material that the world is consuming now, that bodes well for we, the creators of cool imagery, compelling stuff to grab viewers' attention. That's what our clients are asking us for. And that's what a concept artist's job is, to kind of grab their attention and make them see something cool. Good question. I hope I captured the spirit of what you're asking me.
Sounds like it. Okay, another one from YouTube. Yes. Someone's wondering if you can use this technique to create organic things.
Yeah, we sort of talked about doing monsters and faces. And I think, yeah, anything with bilateral symmetry should work for this. I haven't personally tried it myself, but I would like to. I think that could be really cool. And that may be a YouTube video that we need to do in the future. But yeah, it should work for anything that is symmetrical across a midline. This is a front-facing ship, like we're looking at the front. This also works beautifully for like a top-down view of, you know, if we need to really see the wings splayed out, that's a great use of this. So I think there are lots of applications for the symmetry tool, not just this front-facing viewpoint, but anytime you can envision an object and draw that midline down the middle, if it's the same on either side, this can help you design it.
Okay, I'm seeing one more in the Zoom chat here.
Okay.
Can you kindly say how to build up a visual library so that it can help in creating your own concept?
Yeah, that's a big question, because the artist visual library, kind of the well of cool stuff that exists in your brain, that's one of our biggest assets, right? And that just sort of comes from the unique experiences and culture of your own life. Obviously, that's a very big thing. I'm just describing casually in a sentence, but the more you can sort of train your brain to be switched on in that way, the more you can kind of deliberately notice beautiful and interesting things, I think the better off you end up being as a concept artist. If you can just walk around kind of collecting these cool little things, like, I mean, the most random detail, a doorknob, a street light that looks weird in some way. I kind of enjoy the airport just because you can collect interesting characters there. Yeah, I remember taking a flight recently and just thinking, like, that is an awesome old man. Like, he's going to be a Viking warrior in my portfolio soon. So training yourself to observe in that way and really deliberately collect those visual things, I think, is the only shortcut I know of that. I mean, I try to consume as much visual material as I can. I'm a Pinterest junkie just because it leads you from one thing to another. So that's a great resource. But other than that, it's just sort of your own awareness and consuming things that you find cool and filing them away to use them in your own work. Great question. That is really at the core of being a concept artist, kind of being an observer and collector, so that you can put these things back together into your own stuff.
Okay, I think we've got time for just one more question. This one's a pretty big one.
Okay.
Someone's asking on YouTube, how possible is it to get a job and what kind of job as an amateur artist studying with online courses and without a degree?
Sure. I guess I'll address the degree question first. Never once in my concept art career have I been asked, where did you go to school? Where's your diploma from? Which I found crazy. I thought that would be all anybody asked, is just show me the diploma. And that's sort of how they make their mind up about you. But as artists, we're kind of lucky that doesn't really matter for us. Your work is all that matters. That portfolio that prospective client sees, that's what matters. That's all they need to know about you. So I wouldn't really worry about the lack of degree very much at all. That really hasn't affected me. And I think you can really develop professional skills online that is also really incredible to say that our world has reached that point where somebody can get an education that is equal to a traditional art school or university degree. and they can do it entirely at home with their computer and with a support community around. That's amazing, and that's really awesome. Speaking about the job market, I think the opportunities are going up, especially as the world sort of retreats inside in many ways. All of the things that people do to entertain themselves, we are right there in that pipeline. So I think all kinds of entertainment industry jobs, the future definitely seems to be trending in a really great direction for us. So the golden age of the commercial artist may be just kind of starting for us, which is really exciting. There are lots of opportunities in other places too. Video game studios certainly hire concept artists, but there are other kind of lesser known places that a lot of artists get their start, like tabletop games, like the Dungeons and Dragons type franchises of the world. They need tons of art. Any kind of a game that involves a card deck is going to need a new piece of art for every card. And they seem to want entire new decks of cards every year. So it's this really nice, endlessly refreshing well of new business. So the opportunities are out there. Resources like ArtStation are fantastic. There's this daily job email bulletin that you can subscribe to that is always throwing opportunities out there. Now, I definitely want to be very realistic that it is a competitive market. This is a fun, cool job that a lot of people want. And I think everybody who's played a video game that inspired them at some point maybe kind of thought, I sure would like to make these video games for a living. So it's competitive, and it does take a pretty elite portfolio to really stand out, but it's doable. And with the amount of students I have worked with and the amount of real progress that I've seen in insanely short periods of time, I can say that really confidently, that goals are within reach for those who are committed. And if you're bringing some talent to the table on day one, then you're already in a great spot. So I think you can be really optimistic that any goal you set for yourself is within reach if you can kind of commit to achieving it. Man, now that we all have tears in our eyes, we'll just we'll end on that one. But guys, thank you so much for coming today. This was super fun, and I really like how this turned out. So I appreciate you all showing up, and the Q&A was really fun and really outstanding questions. But we'll go ahead and wrap up there. Be sure to check out Digital Painting Studio at the link in the chat. And I am available if anybody has any specific questions. I can be found, and I love helping and talking to artists. That's what I do. So hope you had a good time, and have a great day. See you next time.